Hachette Audio presents Paradise Lodge, written by Nina Stibbe, read by Helen Baxendale.
Part 1. Paradise Lodge. Chapter 1. Linko Beer Shampoo. May 1977. The job at Paradise Lodge was Miranda Longlady's idea. I happened to bump into her outside Poppin' Stores one day and she pointed out a card on the notice board. Paradise Lodge, nursing home for the elderly. Non-unionised auxiliary nurses sought for part-time duties, 35p per hour. Ideal part-time position for outgoing, compassionate females of any age. Miranda wanted to apply and was hoping to talk her sister Melody into going with her. But when Melody came out of the shop with a loaf of take and bake and read the notice, she said it wasn't for her. She'd gone into a punk phase around then and had pierced her upper ear with a needle and an ice cube and had intellectual obscenities felt penned onto her T-shirt. "Go on," Miranda whined. "I don't want to go on my own." While they bickered, I read the card again closely and realised that I wanted the job. I was 15. And I loved the idea of being professionally compassionate. I was longing for something that might blossom into a new phase that didn't involve horses or school or becoming a punk like Melody or having a full-time boyfriend, all of which seemed too exhausting to commit to. Plus, 35p per hour would work out at almost £3 a day, a huge amount then. You could practically live on it. Plus, it was a walkable distance and I was a hater of bus travel. "I'll go with you," I said, and Miranda spun round and looked at me, gone out. We'd never been particularly friendly. Actually, I hated her, and ditto she me. But for the reasons above, I ended up walking with her to the next village to apply in person forthwith, as per the card. The walk to Paradise Lodge was fascinating. Miranda opened up to me about her reason for needing the job, and it was so compelling and romantic, and unlike the Miranda of old, I changed my mind about her. I still didn't like her as such, but she seemed interesting, which was more than could be said for most people. Miranda and her mother were at loggerheads regarding her boyfriend, Mike Yu. Miranda had gone on the pill to be poised to have intercourse with him when the time came, and Mrs. Longlady had twigged it because of Miranda suddenly going up 2 bra sizes in spite of a recent switch from real bread to low-calorie Slimsia. Mrs. Longlady had stopped Miranda's pocket money and was now refusing to give her a penny until she stopped seeing Mike Yu. The real problem was that Mrs. Longlady preferred Miranda's ex, a boy from Market Harborough called Big Smig, who was posh but tried to play it down by swearing and whose dad worked for British Leyland on the admin side and whose mum did charity work for Princess Anne with a horsey connection and was single-handedly arranging 5 interconnecting street parties for the Queen's Silver Jubilee. Miranda's mother was offensive about Mike Yu, calling him Buttercup and saying he was Japanese. This infuriated Miranda because Mike wasn't. He was from Hong Kong, and the people from there are British or Chinese, unless they're another nationality. But they weren't usually Japanese for some reason. Miranda had researched the whole thing thoroughly with an encyclopedia and had even asked Mike Yu about it, even though that had been awkward and intrusive. Miranda had recently had a bad dream in which her mother made a voodoo doll of Mike and stuck a pin in it. While poor Mike writhed in agony in the dream, Miranda had shouted at her mother, "Stop doing voodoo on Mike, I love him!" And it was via the dream that Miranda was first aware that she'd actually fallen in love with Mike. Since then, Miranda's relationship with Mike Yu had become so serious she'd been to dinner twice with the whole Yu family. Mike, his parents, and an old granddad. On the first occasion, they'd had food sent up to their flat from the Good Luck House takeaway, which they owned and was downstairs, and it had been very nice. The second time, though, it was disgusting. Mike Yu's mother had attempted to cook in the English style in her honour, and though it was a kind gesture, Miranda had very nearly been sick at the table. Mike Yu's mother had served great big onions as if they were a vegetable, just cooked whole and plonked at the side of the plate next to a slab of pork. Miranda had struggled with the pork. chewy slash salty, and the onion, slimy slash sweet, and had literally gagged and only just managed to cover it up with a pretend coughing fit. Plus, it hadn't helped that Mike Hughes' old grandad had sat there with his plastic face and glued-up eyes, eating hard-boiled eggs with his fingers. In spite of all this horror, Miranda was so keen on Mike, she'd tried to learn Chinese so they could chat in his language. It had come to nothing, though. Just learning Tuesday, Tinsi Wa, had taken her a week, and then no sooner had she learned Wednesday, Tinsi Tear, than she forgot Tuesday. Miranda had expected it to be a doddle, her mother having become semi-bilingual, English/Spanish, within a matter of weeks when attending a night class. Miranda had thrown in the towel and just spoken in English and signs. She did learn Mike Yu's mother's name, Yu and Ching, which meant quiet, and his father's, Yu Hui Ching, which meant good luck, but hadn't bothered with the old grandad because she didn't want to have to look at him. She thanked God for Mike having an English name, otherwise she might not have been able to go out with him. "But he must have a Chinese name," I said. "No," Miranda assured me. "Mike's Mike in Chinese." Anyway, Miranda needed the job for money to buy clothes and cosmetics to look trendy and attractive for Mike Yu, especially as she had outgrown all her clothes with her new bigger bust. She'd given away her Dorothy Perkins bras to her sister, Melody, who wasn't on the pill and needed the padding and had gone a bit manly in puberty. My reasons for wanting a job didn't seem anywhere near as exciting or romantic as Miranda's, nor as straightforward, which was just as well since there was no time. Her story had lasted the entire 40-minute walk. "There," said Miranda, pointing. "Paradise Lodge." I flicked my fag into the drain and we tiptoed over the cattle grid. Miranda, being in high shoes, was cautious and had to watch her footing. Looking down, I saw a walking stick lying in the oily water in the pit underneath. "Jesus," said Miranda, wobbling a bit. "There's no way the old cunts are escaping from here." We knocked, and while we waited, I gazed around and saw a lady at the window above the door. She wasn't looking out, but had both hands and her cheek on the glass. A thing my brother Jack used to do when he wanted our mother to come home. He'd have to keep rubbing his breath off the glass. Eventually, the front door was opened by an old nurse who took us through to a large, steamy kitchen. A woman in an apron introduced herself as the cook and announced it was almost tea time. She gestured us to sit, and she began ladling hot, stringy fruit from a great copper pan into bottles lined up at the other end of the scrubbed table. By the look of it, I guessed it was stewed rhubarb. We were joined then by a woman of around 40 called Ingrid, who was very tall and obviously the boss. "Shall we have some tea?" she said, looking at the cook. And the cook smiled and said, "Yes, let's, and a scone perhaps." We were interviewed there together at the table. Trays of tea foods were lined up along a dresser, and a little gaggle of nurses appeared and took the trays, and the cook filled two catering teapots with boiling water, and it was like the nicest tea you've ever seen from days gone by or a royal palace. The whole thing was delightful, except I noticed Ingrid had very red eyes and had either been crying for ages or had something wrong with her. If I'd been her, I'd have said, "Sorry about my red eyes, I've got a bit of hay fever," whether I had or not. But she didn't say anything about it. It's strange now, calling her Ingrid, because after that first meeting, she was only ever known as the owner's wife. And though this seems wrong now, that's how it was. Also, I'm not 100% sure her name was Ingrid. It might have been Inga or Irena. I only know it began with the vowel and meant divine strength in Old Norse. You can look it up. The interview was brief. She told us the golden rules for working with the elderly and asked if we'd had any experience with an aga, which she said was the heart of the house. Miranda hadn't, but I had, and I was able to speak intelligently about riddling and raking. The cook particularly looked pleased to hear it. The owner's wife then asked us why we wanted the job. I answered first, explaining that my family couldn't afford two types of shampoo or two types of coffee, so I was stuck with Vosine and Woolco's Econo Coffee, which was half coffee, half chicory extract. And since my sister...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.